Thank you. Good morning, and welcome to the First Presbyterian Church on this beautiful Lord's Day. Just a few announcements before we begin worship. Our nominating committee will meet this Tuesday at 6 p.m. in the annex, and then the Board of Deacons will meet the same day, Tuesday, at 6:30 p.m. in the annex. And we'll have Bible study in the annex on Wednesday at 7 p.m. We'll also be live streaming Bible study on the church Facebook page. And don't forget, our adult Sunday school class has just begun a study of Philippians. It's not too late to jump in. So if you would like to join them, you can show up next Sunday at 10 a.m. or talk to Elder Montgomery and he will give you the Zoom link. So let's be called to worship with these words from Psalm 105. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing psalms to him. Talk of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Let's worship our God as we stand and sing his praise.
Invisible, whether they be And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence.
For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell.
And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven.
Let us now praise our Lord Christ, who is so great. As we turn in our hymnals, we'll turn to selection 32. And we'll sing all four stanzas of How Great Thou Art. We'll sing all four stanzas and let us stand to sing.
Thank you.
let us now say what we believe about him using the words of the Apostles' Creed, found inside the front cover of the hymnal or in your online order of service. Christian, what do you believe?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Catholic believers, our cup runs over. The last 10 days have been a joint effort of those above, a small group of volunteers at First Thibodeaux, community leaders, and personal friends, old and new. In 10 days, we have seen God move through the generosity of the presbytery, local people, friends, family, and strangers from across the country. By your gifts, we have been able to do some amazing things. We have paid to tarp 3 homes that had no available person to fix it. We've served through a food pantry at First Thibodeaux 150 households representing 554 people in 10 days. With the work of ACT, we have helped serve 1,500 hot meals in Point Washane, where we have, with your donations, set up a satellite relief warehouse larger than the one in Thibodeaux. We've given food, water, and gasoline to hundreds of residents in the Point Washane area and built connections with the Garber Indians and the local fire department. Not only have you sent so much in supply and financial support, but already volunteers have helped us make deliveries in the home and other places further south. Volunteers have helped to clean out 2 houses and move members' furniture into First Poma, which is currently closed due to its own damage. Financial support has flooded in. At least 4 congregations have made large cash contributions to make sure we can meet expenses and needs. Thank you. What is next? The 3 R's of a disaster, this is good to remember, the 3 R's of a disaster are relief, meaning the basic needs of daily survival, recovery, which is save valuables that cannot be replaced and mitigate further damage, and rebuild, help people put their lives back together. We're already wrapping up the relief phase. I've never seen it happen so quickly. We already have more than enough water. We have more than enough food. Gasoline has gone from a 1-hour wait to almost no lines in Thibodeaux. But down the bayou, further south, they're still catching up. By your gifts, we have delivered over 200 gallons of gas at the Point of Shame, and about that much has been used in Homer and Thibodeaux. Recovery. Recovery is going to be a heavy lift. As we say, we're all in the pot. I'm still without power. I do have a generator, but I'm living in my neighbor's house. Put the cook team in my house this week, thanks to a generator provided from folks in West Louisiana. I might be home next week, but literally everyone has damage. We have only 2 members in the 2 congregations who have power. The rest of us are all generators if we have those. Several moved home, then their generators failed, and they had to move back out. The damage is just astounding. I can drive for 3 hours in one direction without leaving this zone. As I go south, it just gets worse and worse. As you try to help us, be patient. We can likely only handle 1 group at a time for now. Saturday's maybe the best time, but we can't handle everyone at once. There's plenty of work. We're surrounded by it. But knowing where to point you takes time and planning. Right now, I'd love to have some small groups, even as small as 2 or 3. We need drivers with pickup trucks push materials south. We can work with a few here and there to help folks sort their belongings. Of course, in the rebuilding phase, we want to rebuild several homes, and we'll need skilled labor for that work. I hope to get more organized about inviting folks in. It will be a collaborative effort and require entrepreneurial attitude and an adventurous spirit. I don't even know what else is going on in the world. But for the last 10 days, we've been living in the eye of the storm. And we're grateful that the eye of the Lord is on the sparrow and that he watches us to the point that he knows the hairs of our heads. This is a long report, but it's written out of a sense of amazement and joy. There's so much work to do and so many stories to tell. Each day full and each night restful. Clarity comes in the storm. What matters most is made crystal clear. But clarity comes and grows each day as we experience relief and recovery, and as we are rebuilt by the Holy Spirit. God bless you all. We love you and thank you. Bill Crawford from Homo and Thibodeaux. Let's celebrate God, whose eye is on the sparrow, as we take up our hymnals. We'll turn to selection 68. And remember how sweet the name of Jesus is, Jesus who died for us and who takes care of our every need. We'll sing all 5 stanzas of hymn 68 from the pen of the same author. Amazing Grace. Hymn 68, let us stand to sing. Plans and the refugees that have formed friendships with them. Bless those who are sick today, those who are in the hospital today, those who are recovering from surgery today, those who are anticipating surgery later on. Lord, in so many ways, it is easy for us to feel overwhelmed when we are helpless. But those are the times, Lord, we need you the most. And so we simply ask that you would be with us, that you would fill our hearts with your Holy Spirit, not only so that we might understand your word, but so that we might trust you more, even when things don't make sense, especially when things don't make sense. For we offer this prayer in the name of the head of the church, even our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who is somehow Son of God and yet Son of Man, the one who somehow died and yet through God defeated death, the one who somehow has gone to be in your presence and yet promises to come again. We pray in his name. Our scripture reading today comes from Matthew's Gospel, the last verse of chapter 16, and reading through the first 13 verses of chapter 17. And if we think things in our world and in our lives don't make any sense, well, hang on. This may be the most confusing, most mind-blowing passage in all of the New Testament. Jesus said in verse 28 of Matthew 16, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them. And his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here 3 tabernacles, 3 tents, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elias." While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him." Listen to him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, "Arise and be not afraid." And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. And as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, saying, "Tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead." And his disciples asked him, saying, "Why then say the scribes that Elias must first come?" And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Elias truly shall first come and restore all things. But I say unto you that Elias is come already." And they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they listed, whatever they wanted. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them. Then the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. That is God's word. But let's face it, nothing about this makes any sense. Why did Jesus reveal his glory this way? Why was it so temporary? Why did Elijah and Moses suddenly show up on the mountain and just as suddenly disappear? It's also otherworldly. It's also beyond us. But at the same time, it's obvious that Jesus intended for Peter and James and John to see all of this, for why else had he taken them up on the mountain? In fact, in the first verse of this passage, Jesus told the disciples that some of them would not taste death until they had seen the kingdom of God in power. And if the transfiguration was not a glimpse of the kingdom of God in power, what is? So why did Jesus show Peter, James, and John all these things if they were not going to be able to understand them? Well, maybe he just wanted them to get a glimpse of his glory, to drive into their thick heads exactly who he is. But if that's the case, then their reaction may be the most confusing thing of all in this story. For think about it. Put yourself in Peter's place. Jesus is standing over there and he's glowing. And then Moses and Elijah show up. And the first thing you can say, Peter, is, "Lord, it is good for us to be here." Really, Peter? Really? Even in the presence of the transfiguration, this overwhelming, mind-blowing vision of Christ's glory, you can't stop thinking about yourself? Even such a sublime, even such a divine vision doesn't move you to self-abandonment, to worship, to praise? No. Instead of looking outward, instead of looking upward, Peter's focus is relentlessly inward. He is not saying, "How great thou art." He's saying, "It's good for us to be here." Bless his heart. But before we're too hard on Peter, we really need to ask the question. We really need to look in the mirror and ask ourselves, are we really so different? Now, Peter saw a confusing and fleeting vision of Christ's glory. Yes, but what about us? I mean, we have seen Jesus with clearer eyes, haven't we? For we know the end of the story. We know about the passion and the justice of God that would go on to be displayed in the cross. We understand what confused the disciples so much in verse 9, for we have read of the triumphant splendor of the empty tomb. And because Jesus has already ascended into heaven, we know he will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, a glory on that day that will put the transfiguration to shame. We know all of this. We know this much more clearly than Peter did that day on the mountain. But day in and day out, is the focus of our lives so different from his? Do we really live in a more worshipful existence than Peter did? Are we really living for God's glory? Or like Peter, are we more concerned with what we can get out of this discipleship deal? Are we focused on serving Christ and bearing witness for Christ, or are we just grasping for the peace or the joy or the contentment or whatever else it is that he promises? Sure, we have heard the words of Christ, but are we really listening to him any more than Peter was? Bless Peter's heart. He of foot-in-mouth disease. First he says, "It is good for us to be here." And then he makes this crazy comment about three tents, three tabernacles. Now what's that all about? Gazing at the splendor of this glorious trio on the mountainside, how could Peter possibly imagine they would be interested in any sort of a shanty that he could patch together on the spur of the moment? For the transfigured, glorified Christ to hang out in a tabernacle built of sticks and branches? Well, that would be like a president of General Motors descending from his Cadillac Escalade and being offered a big wheel to ride on. Bless his heart. But again, I wonder, before we go on being too hard on Peter, I wonder if we don't fall into similar ways of thinking sometimes. I wonder if we don't sometimes overestimate the value of our efforts. What did we sing about in our first hymn? "When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and through the birds sing sweetly in the trees." Here we are in Southwest Mississippi, and we get to do that all the time. We get to enjoy the splendor and the grandeur of God's creation. But isn't it easy for us, even in the midst of all of that, to go on being proud, to imagine that this world is here for us, for our use, only for our enjoyment? Even when, as the hymn writer goes on, and we meditate on the sacrifice of Christ, when I think that God, His Son, not sparing, sent Him to die, isn't it still somehow possible for us to imagine that our feeble attempts at righteousness matter? That we somehow still have the power to make ourselves somehow acceptable in the sight of God, or at the very least, that our efforts can make us better than, you know, those people we like to look down on? Bless Peter's heart, but maybe we also need to open our ears and listen, really listen, to what the Bible says about the seriousness of our sin, about how deeply ingrained it is in our souls. And maybe if we would look, if we would really look at the radiance of Jesus' glory, we would realize how far we have fallen from the image of God in which we were created. Maybe if we would look, if we would really look at the dazzling white purity of the garments of Christ, maybe we could realize just how soiled and how stained our garments are. Maybe then, if we listen and if we look, we would realize that there's no place for pride and there's no place for complacency. Maybe then we would remember our weakness and how desperately we need Christ and Christ alone to reconcile us to God, to make peace with God through the blood of His cross. But there's another possible reason that Peter makes this crazy comment about building stick shanties. Maybe he wasn't just focused on what he could somehow do to prove himself worthy in the sight of Christ. Maybe he was also desiring to somehow prolong that mountaintop experience. Maybe he was hoping that by providing some lodging, that he could make the glory, the splendor last just a little bit longer. Now, I think we can understand that. We've all had vacations we didn't want to come to an end. We've all had wonderful evenings with friends that we didn't want to go home and go to bed. Who wouldn't want to linger in such a transcendent moment as the Transfiguration was? But perhaps Peter's mention of these three tabernacles, maybe that indicates, maybe that points to an even deeper longing. For you see, in the Old Testament, the Feast of Tabernacles was a time when God's people lived in handmade shanties made out of sticks or branches or things like that for a whole week. And in this festival, they were thus looking back and remembering the way God had brought His people out of Egypt at the time of the Exodus. And then in those tents, remembering that they had tented all during those 40 years. But the week-long celebration didn't just look back. It also looked forward. It looked forward to the time when God was going to deliver His people again. A time when God was going to return to earth to make real what the tabernacle of Moses and the temple of Solomon could only symbolize. The dwelling place of God with His people. Every year at the feast, the people remember God's promise that God was going to pitch His tent alongside His people, not just symbolically for a week, but in a very real and permanent way, forever and ever. And maybe when Peter saw Moses and Elijah on the mountain and he saw the glorified Christ, maybe he thought, this is it. The kingdom of God has finally come. This is the end of history. So let's have the Feast of the Tabernacles and let's stay up here on the mountain forever. Why couldn't he stay? Well, we know why. We know why Moses and Elijah vanished into the cloud as suddenly as they had appeared We know why Jesus resumed his previous merely human appearance. We know why the disciples could not linger on the mountaintop. We know there was much work left for Jesus to do. We know he had not come to earth to stay, not that time. And that's what he'd been trying to explain to the disciples, even before they had gone up on the mountain, that yes, he was the Messiah, yes, he was the Son of Man, but no, he wasn't going to fulfill all their expectations, not right then. That's why the transfiguration couldn't be permanent. It wasn't time to build those tabernacles. Jesus first had to suffer many things, and then to die. And that's why Jesus mentioned the coming of Elijah, that John the Baptist had in fact come in the spirit and power of Elijah to restore all things, just as the prophet Malachi said he would. But the leaders of the day had not received John's message. The leaders of the day had not listened to John any more closely than the disciples were listening to Jesus. Instead, King Herod had done to John whatever he wanted. He threw him in jail and then put him to death. And what had happened to John was going to happen to Jesus. That's what he was trying to tell his disciples. That's what he was telling them. But it wasn't the first time. Go back to the passage we read last week. Jesus had made it clear. He had to suffer. He had to be rejected. He had to be killed. He had to die before he could rise from the dead and come again in glory. And it was precisely the impermanence of the transfiguration, in addition to all of this teaching, that was trying to make this clear to the disciples, the difference between Jesus' first coming and his second coming. He was trying to explain it to them. He was trying to show it to them. But they didn't listen. They didn't listen. They continued to expect him to bring blessings in this world right then. They continued to expect him at any moment to declare the kingdom of God on earth, to expel the Romans and rule Jerusalem. And they wanted to build those tabernacles. They wanted to celebrate the coming of the kingdom in all its fullness. They wanted it all. They wanted it right then. And so this may just be the most confusing thing of all about the transfiguration. How in the world could those disciples, how could they follow Jesus? How could they see his miracles? How could they hear his words? How could they believe and acknowledge that he is the Messiah sent from God? How could they catch a vision of his heavenly glory? How could they do all of that and not listen to him? Even when God the Father himself descended from heaven in a terrifying cloud and spoke directly to them in the same way that he had thundered the Ten Commandments from the top of Mount Sinai, even when the Father said, "This is my beloved Son, listen to him," they didn't listen. They didn't listen. They didn't listen for the whole rest of the Gospel of Matthew. Oh, sure, they followed Jesus for a while. They followed him until they could no longer deny that he had not come for a crown, but for a cross. But when they saw him meekly surrender to Judas and the mob in the garden, when they saw him standing before Pilate and not even saying a word, all their hopes of earthly glory vanished, and they abandoned him and did not listen. Not until he rose from the dead. So, we know he's risen from the dead. But what's it going to take for us to listen? We know who Jesus is. We say it every Sunday morning in the Apostles' Creed. We know he is the Son of God. What's it going to take for us to listen to him? What's it going to take for us to gaze upon his shining white garments and recognize and realize and reject the remnants of sin in our lives? What's it going to take for us to listen to Him, to turn away from ourselves and worship and glorify Him alone. We know Jesus is the Savior of the world, but what's it going to take for us to listen to Him? What's it going to take for us to trust in Him alone to save us, putting aside all our feeble attempts to earn God's favor? What's it going to take for us to rest in the all-sufficient sacrifice of the cross? We know Jesus is the Son of David. We know He holds all power in heaven and earth in His hands. But what's it going to take for us to listen? In the face of hurricanes and pandemics, in the face of fear and frustration and grief, what is it going to take for us to put all of that aside, all of our worry, all of our despair, all of our discouragement? What's it going to take for us to trust Him to provide for us in His way and in His time? What's it going to take? What is it going to take for us to put aside our demands for immediate happiness and comfort in this world? What is it going to take for us to give our lives completely to Him? To live only for His glory, even if suffering or persecution might come our way. Our Messiah has been revealed to us in glory. He has come to save us from sin and death. The Son of God has come to rule and to reign over every aspect, every corner of every one of our lives. While we wait for His return, He calls us. He calls us to follow Him, even to the cross of self-denial, self-sacrifice. The one who is calling, the one who is speaking to us, is our Savior and our Shepherd, our Lord and our King. Will we listen? Will we listen? Let us pray. Lord, we know what You have said to us. We know what You have done for us. We know who You are. We know what You call us to do. We know You have called us to trust You. Help us, Lord, to listen. And help us to trust You in every circumstance of our lives, with all that we are and all that we have. For we offer this prayer in the name of the one who gave up everything He is and everything He has for us, even our Lord Jesus. Let's continue that prayer as we take up our hymnals. We'll turn to selection 366. Selection 366. My faith looks up to Thee. We'll sing all four stanzas and let us stand to sing.
Yeah.
calls us to trust in his love and his power. And now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and